One of my mantras in life is this: no shame, no judgment, just learning. This mantra has come into my life via many spiritual paths, the main one being how spending 20 years as an atheist stripped away all that was keeping me from a deep and holy encounter with God. Simply put, atheism stripped me of the shame and judgment that was keeping me from God's unconditional love. Atheism left me standing naked before God. I became a born-again Christian when I was a teenager. Now, as you're probably aware, teenagers think they know it all and that they have all the answers to life's problems. This fit well with my newfound spiritual path, for the faith I professed at that time taught me that I had the truth. What better situation can a teenager find themselves in than to be told in the midst of their raging hormones and swirling adolescent emotions that you now possess the truth?
I have the power!
Anyway, as a teenager I saw the world in stark terms. I had an either-or mentality, a worldview that married nicely with my Christian faith at the time. Either you were for Jesus or you were not. Either you professed to know Jesus as I did or you did not. Either you professed a faith in Jesus in the same manner I had, the so-called true way, or you did not. This also led me to live in a world where I felt very unsafe. Those who were not like me were treated with suspicion. Even those who professed to be a Christian were treated with suspicion, especially if they did not profess the same beliefs as myself. I was right, and unless you proved to me otherwise, which was highly unlikely, you were wrong. You couldn't profess to know Jesus and not be like me. If you claimed to know God, then you were like me. Right? Not Jesus, not God, just me. Like me. Was I a narcissist? Absolutely. Looking back on this time, I was enmeshed in some very unhealthy ways of thinking about myself, others, God, Jesus, my faith, and the world in general. I was the center of the universe. It was all about me. I also had a lot of fear, the fear being primarily that of contamination. I feared becoming impure. I feared being made spiritually dirty by friends, family, other Christians, non-Christians, basically the whole world. In fact, I felt I was at risk from anything that was simply not me. As such, this fear led my faith to become legalistic. I needed a way to keep the purity in and the contaminants out. My faith was grounded on following the rules. There was also no freedom. Free will was dubious and had left the door open to error. I was taught that Adam and Eve had been given free will, and that turned out really bad for the world. So no freedom, and also no freedom to negotiate or improvise. One did not question, one simply obeyed. I also saw myself as a sinner, someone who was naturally inclined to disobey God's commands, and as such, I couldn't be trusted. I needed direction. I needed clear and unquestionable truth in my life, and also a clear and unquestionable way of living. It was either this or that, not both and. I also needed to know the fundamentals of my faith. Any idea that I could trust myself to discern God's truth was dangerous. To think that there was any good in me was also wrong. Emotions would easily lead me astray from God, especially when they were connected to sexual desire. Nope. To be a true Christian, one needed to be emotionally shut down when it came to God. In fact, one needed to get as far away from the body and the world as you could get, dwelling with God in the heavens, mentally, intellectually, in your head. Having faith and being a Christian was about getting away from yourself, from others, and the physical world. To do this, one focused on reading and studying the Bible, God's written word, and literally following its commands. And you either did that, or you were going to hell. Then one day, I came to my senses. Separating God from the world has had a catastrophic effect on humanity. In Western cultures, the physical realm has been denied any intrinsic sacredness. From this came the rise of industrialization and this led to a full exploitation of the natural world to such an extent that we are now in danger of permanently eradicating ourselves from the physical realm via our own extinction. However, even if one disputes an impending catastrophic global climate change, the effects of treating the physical realm as other can be seen simply through the manner in which people casually discard litter and trash across the natural landscape. It's also the product of living in a world which has no intrinsic value, purpose, or function other than to serve humanity's needs. Removing God from the physical realm has also led people to treat their body not as a sacred space for the divine to dwell, but as yet another thing to use and consume. This can be readily seen in our modern working environment, where humans have become another cog in a global industrial machine, a means to an end, existing simply to serve the purposes of production and then later on, consumption. Therefore, in a world where God is absent, humans have no intrinsic value. They are instead valued according to how much they produce or consume, as any loyalty rewards program or work bonus scheme will show. This is in stark contrast to the biblical notion that humans are created in God's image and born with an intrinsic value attached to them. For God, our value is not grounded in anything we produce, acquire, or consume. It just is. In terms of our relationships, when life becomes simply about this world, then the purpose of life quickly becomes how much we can acquire in the world, such as experiences or things, and attempt to satisfy ourselves with them. Of course, it doesn't take much to see that attempts to satisfy oneself with physical things and experiences alone is a bottomless pit. There is no final sense of satisfaction to be found in these things alone. So as an atheist living in a world devoid of God, I soon found myself in a pit of despair. However, when I chose to put God back into my life, it opened up a new and radical way to see myself. I began to see myself and others as highly valued and dignified beings. We have intrinsic worth, and as a Christian, this is most dramatically realized in the person of Jesus Christ. For the notion that God took human form is a significant reorientation of the divine towards the physical realm. Jesus is God's yes to you, me, and the world. The idea that the world is impure and untouchable by God is something that cannot be justified when we consider Jesus as the fullness of God in human form. Here's another truism. However much we might try to intellectualize or capture Jesus' divinity in creeds or statements of faith, the fact is that it will remain first and foremost an experience. My own profession of Christ's divinity has nothing to do with anything I have read in a creed or been required to profess. It's simply my experience of Jesus. In Jesus, I have experienced the full and unconditional love of God. When I think about Jesus, when I dwell in the presence of Jesus, I cannot but feel that I am also dwelling in the presence of God, the unconditional love of God. For me, that experience has been transformative. My life has been lifted out of the pit because of Jesus. But more than that, it has also been transformed by the absurd notion that we too can become like Jesus. This really is an absurd notion, that it is possible for us to reveal the essence of God's unconditional love to each other as it has been realized in Jesus. It's quite simply absurd. And here is another absurd truism. God's written word can also be made known in human form. As John writes in his gospel, "The word became flesh and dwelt among us." Jesus is God's word made known in human form. You want to know what the Bible is about? Then look at Jesus. This too is true of us. For as we dwell in the written word of God and reflect on the call for us to show up in love for each other, we also become like Jesus, the living Word of God. God's Word does not remain static on the page, but lives in us and through us. This too is a high calling, and one that far surpasses anything we might find in a world devoid of God, or any form of Christian faith that seeks to radically separate God from us and the world. God is found in the physical realm. God is also found in us and through us. Us, each of us, with our often tragic and tarnished lives, we are capable of revealing God to each other. The idea that we are sinners, that all have sinned, is not meant to lead to a separation of God and humanity, but simply to level the playing field. None of us are perfect. None of us get to judge the lives of others free of the finger pointing back at us. When we immerse ourselves into God's unconditional love, we're not rejected, but we get to live as sinners who are more than the sum of our worst moments. With Jesus, our life gets to be transformed and made new. We get to become a new creation. Paul, in his first letter to the Corinthians, ventures even further. We get to become ambassadors for Christ. We get to be Christ's representatives on earth. So, in a world where one mistake will get you cancelled out for good, God says through Jesus, none of us will ever be cancelled out. Because of Jesus, nothing will ever take us away from God's love. Nothing, nothing, nothing. God says, I will cancel your sins, but I will never cancel you out. Nothing will ever separate you from me. You will always remain my beloved child. You are the one in whom I am well pleased. With Jesus, you are invited by God to receive the inheritance prepared for you for all eternity. So the question begs, will you receive it? I hope so, for where else will you find such a high value placed on you? Affirm your presence in the world. You laid down to sleep and then you awoke. You have been sustained. You are meant to be here. Express gratitude for life. Name some things you are grateful for. Your life is being perfected. You are being opened up to new things. This is always the work of God. Growth, enlarging, expanding. Where things are being removed, it is in order to make space for something else. Do not resist the natural pruning of things. The branches are pruned so that they will become even more fruitful. Here is a prayer. Oh, that you would bless me and enlarge my territory. Let your hand be with me and keep me from harm so that I will be free from pain. Now affirm this truth. God, as you understand God to be, unconditionally loves you. Dwell in the presence of unconditional love. Nothing is expected of you to receive this love. It just is. Hear the voice of God calling you. This is how love is made complete among us. In this world, we are like Jesus. Thank you for this new day and new beginning. Fill me with the Spirit to live a holy other life. Where I have wronged others, embolden me to make things right. Where I have been wronged, help me to forgive and let things go. Keep me attentive to where I'm being led into new things. Overcome my fears. Strengthen me to follow the path of justice, mercy, and love. May I live as Jesus Christ lived. Let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be uplifting, positive, supportive, and inspiring to others. May I be curious and always seek to build up rather than tear down. This podcast is unashamedly about changing lives. All those involved in its conception and birth believe that life can and should be lived well, and that goes for all of us. We believe in the unlimited potential for everyone to do amazing things and to be amazing people. Whoever you are and wherever you are, we believe you are awesome. We also believe that when we immerse ourselves into the presence of unconditional love, that incredible things start to happen. We're excited to have you join with us.